Hello all. Now, today we will discuss about the drugs antimicrobial which inhibit protein synthesis in a bacteria. Okay. For that, first we must know how protein synthesis occurs. Remember, protein synthesis occurs through translation of mRNA. Okay. Translation of mRNA causes protein synthesis. Now, who will do translation? You know that when ribosomes, they come and attach on the surface of mRNA, they do translation of proteins, translation of mRNA. So ribosomes are responsible for translation. So this assembly of mRNA with ribosome is known as polysome. So this polysome causes translation of mRNA and protein are synthesized. Now let's see how protein synthesis occur. We know that protein, it is a chain of amino acid. When amino acid, they links among themselves, they form protein. Now on this ribosomes, remember there are two sites. Okay, there are two sites. If we talk about in bacteria, the ribosomes are of 70S type. Okay, and this 70S ribosome has two subunits, 50S and 30S. Okay. It is further divided into two, 50 and 30S ribosome. Okay, so let's call this bigger subunit as 50 and smaller as 30. Now let's see how protein synthesis occur. On this 30S ribosome, there is a site known as A site. A stand for attachment site. And on 50S, there is a site known as P site. Why it is known as P site? I will tell you that here, there is an enzyme known as peptidyl transferase, which will form peptide bond between two amino acids. Let's see how protein synthesis occur. First of all, we know that proteins, they are the polymers or the linkage of amino acids. Now amino acid, they are carried out by a tRNA, and tRNA attaches to A site. That is why A site is known as attachment site. So amino acids, they come and bind to this site. So this first step is inhibited by two antibacterials. The first is known as tetracyclines, and the second, a modification of tetracyclines known as TA cycline. Okay, this tetracycline and TA cycline, they block 30S ribosome, and they inhibit this attachment of, what is the mechanism action? You will write that they inhibit attachment of amino acyl or amino acid tRNA to which site? To A site. Okay, so they inhibit attachment of amino acid or amino acyl tRNA to A site. Okay, now what happens when this amino acid generally comes and attaches to this A site? This amino acid changes its location and come to P site. This step is known as translocation. Okay, this second step of translocation, it is inhibited by three drugs. You'll write MCQ. These drugs are macrolides. They will end with the word thromycin, like azithromycin, Second, you will write clindamycin. Okay, Now clindamycin is under a group of antibacterial known as lincosamide. Okay, Then we have a drug known as quinpristine and dalfopristine. This is a combination of two drugs. This drug is a combination of two drugs, and this combination is known as streptogramins. Now these three drugs, you will write MCQ, they come and they block this translocation by blocking 50S ribosome. So you will write they block 50S ribosome and they inhibit translocation of amino acid. And these three drugs, they have exactly same mechanism of action, all three. Because of this reason, If a bacteria becomes resistant to one of them, let's say macrolide, then the bacteria will also become resistant to clindamycin and streptogramin. Because of this reason, these three antibacterials, they show cross resistance among themselves. So this is an important question you must remember, that macrolide, clindamycin and streptogramins, they show cross resistance among themselves. Okay, they show cross resistance among themselves. Okay, now let's come to the third drug. Now what happens further? When this amino acid generally it changes its location and come to A site, can we say the amino acid which was at P site, the amino acid, this A site again becomes empty? Depending upon the next codon, a new amino acid, it generally comes and bind to A site. Now both A and P site, they have one amino acid. Now why it is known as P site? Because it contains one enzyme, peptidyl transferase. It contains an enzyme, peptidyl transferase. This peptidyl transferase will create a peptide bond between these two amino acids present at A and P site. Hence, we know that proteins, they are the linkage of amino acid. Now similarly, this A site amino acid will translocate again, and the amino acid at P site will go out of this ribosome, and this way the whole protein synthesis or protein chain will form. Okay, now the third drug we have which inhibit this peptidyl transferase is, so you will write that third drug, the third drug which inhibit this peptidyl transferase is chloramphenicol. Okay, chloramphenicol. Chloramphenicol, you will write, it comes and block 50S ribosome and it inhibit peptidyl transferase. It inhibit peptidyl transferase enzyme. Okay, it inhibits peptidyl transferase enzyme. Now let's talk about two drugs which are, compare them, we will compare them. The first is aminoglycosides. Aminoglycosides, and second you will write is linezolid. Second is linezolid. Now if you talk about aminoglycoside, aminoglycoside block multiple site. They block multiple sites of 30S and 50S, and they block multiple steps, and they block multiple steps also. These multiple steps are, you will write, IMP. They inhibit initiation of protein synthesis. They inhibit initiation of protein synthesis. Okay, so protein synthesis will not start. They cause misreading of mRNA. Misreading means a different form of amino acid will come and bind, hence a defective protein will be formed, and they also inhibit formation of polysome. They inhibit polysome formation. We know that polysome is an assembly of ribosome with mRNA. Now if you compare with the linezolid, linezolid block very specific site. It block very specific site. Okay, that very specific site is, you'll write 23S subunit of, 23S subunit of 50S ribosome. Okay, and it inhibit a very specific step. It only inhibit attachment of, it only inhibit attachment of methionine tRNA. So very specific step, methionine tRNA. And we know that methionine tRNA, this methionine is the first amino acid in all protein synthesis. The initiation codon in protein synthesis codes for methionine, that is AUG. So methionine is required for initiation of protein synthesis. So remember, aminoglycosides, they act at multiple site and they block multiple step. While linezolid, it act at a very specific site and it block a very specific step. That specific site is 23S subunit of 50S ribosome and it inhibit attachment of methionine tRNA. Okay, so these are the protein synthesis inhibitors we have. Now let's write certain important points, notable points which you have to remember. First point. Okay, the first point is the drugs that block 30S ribosome. The drug that block 30S ribosome are, if you see, can we say aminoglycoside, they block 30S ribosome? And apart from this, only tetracycline and tigecycline, they block 30S ribosome. So you will write the drug that block 30S ribosomes are ATT. That is aminoglycoside. Okay. Tetracycline. Okay. And the congener of tetracycline, tigecycline. Okay. Now second point is, which of the following are bactericidal? Remember, only two drugs are bactericidal, namely you will write A and S. A for again aminoglycoside, bactericidal, and you can write streptogramins, quinpristine and alfopristine. These are bactericidal. Rest are bacteriostatic drugs. Rest all other drugs are bacteriostatic. But there is certain exception out here. There is one exception, that linezolid. You will write linezolid. If you talk about linezolid, is for certain bacteria it is static, and for certain bacteria it is bactericidal. You will write linezolid is static for Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus. And it is also static for Enterococcus. While linezolid is cidal for Streptococcus pneumoniae. It is cidal for Streptococcus pneumoniae. So remember, one drug could be cidal for one bacteria and static for another bacteria. Okay, so try to remember this part. Now the last point you have to remember is their spectrum of activity. If you talk about their spectrum, they are divided into three. Okay, they are divided into three. Either they are divided into broad spectrum, intermediate spectrum, and lastly narrow spectrum. Okay, lastly narrow spectrum. Among broad spectrum, we have a drug chloramphenicol. Okay, broad spectrum drug is chloramphenicol, and tetracycline groups and tetracyclines. In intermediate, you will write we have macrolides. Okay, and the drugs which are very effective for very less number of bacteria, you'll write those drugs are clindamycin, okay, you'll write linezolid, aminoglycosides, and lastly streptogramins. So they are narrow spectrum drug. Okay, they have narrow spectrum. Okay, so try to remember. So let's start with the first one, that is chloramphenicol, and we will discuss these drugs in this similar order now. Okay, so let's make a heading, chloramphenicol. So chloramphenicol is a broad spectrum drug. It is effective in variety of bacterias. So you will write, what was the mechanism of action of chloramphenicol? If we recapitulate, chloramphenicol block 50S ribosome, and chloramphenicol inhibit peptidyl transferase enzyme. Okay, it blocks peptidyl transferase enzyme. Okay. Now the point is, chloramphenicol is a very old drug. Now, majority of the bacteria, they have acquired resistant against chloramphenicol. So chloramphenicol is nowadays very rarely used because of two reasons. I will be telling you. The first reason is most of the bacteria, they have acquired resistance, and chloramphenicol now is not effective against them. Example, chloramphenicol now is not active against, because they have now become completely resistant, you will write again typhoid. Earlier it was the drug of choice for typhoid. Now chloramphenicol is permanently resistant typhoid bacteria, which is caused by Salmonella typhi, is completely resistant to chloramphenicol. Similarly, you will write Shigella dysentery, it has become totally resistant. And lastly, you will write Pseudomonas. So these bacteria, which are the group of Enterobacteriaceae family, have become totally resistant. Okay. Now, what is the cause of resistance? Now, cause of resistance is because these bacteria have started producing enzymes, and chloramphenicol becomes enzymatically degraded by the enzymes which are produced by the bacteria. So resistance against chloramphenicol is due to enzymatically degradation. So the enzyme which degrades chloramphenicol is known as CAT enzyme. This CAT enzyme degrades chloramphenicol. CAT stand for chloramphenicol acetyl transferase. Chloramphenicol acetyl transferase. These bacteria have started producing this enzyme. Okay. Now just remember one point for your information, that against which group of antimicrobial the bacteria have produced enzymes that degrade those antimicrobial. You'll write enzymatic degradation is produced against three main group of antibacterials. You'll write ABC. Against ABC group of antibacterials, and the bacteria have started producing enzyme. A for aminoglycosides, against them also enzymes are formed and they become neutralized. Beta lactamase enzymes are formed. And lastly, we have already written chloramphenicol. So against these three bacteria, against these three antimicrobial, bacteria has become resistant, has acquired resistance because of formation of enzymes. Okay, so try to remember ABC. Okay, so try to remember. So let's see what are the uses of chloramphenicol. For before that, we will write first point, use. Remember, chloramphenicol can be given orally and it can be given IV. It can be given IV, and when it is given oral or IV, it has a very good CSF penetration. It has a good CSF or brain penetration. It goes into the brain because as it is a very broad spectrum drug and it enters into the brain very easily, it is used as a empirical. Empirical means when we don't know what is which bacteria or pathogen is causing a disease, it is used in empirical treatment of meningitis. Okay, meningitis. Empirical means when you don't know which bacteria has caused, we are just guessing. Okay, so it's a broad spectrum drug, it will cover most of the bacteria. So it has a very good CSF penetration and it is given as a empirical treatment of serious infections like meningitis and other serious infection, like you can write bacterial meningitis, that we already know. It is given in cases of bacterial meningitis and certain other serious infections which could be life-threatening, like rickettsial disease. So it is given as a reserve drug in these cases. Okay, so it is given as a reserve drug. It is not routine usually. It is not the drug of choice. Okay, so remember this part. Now if you talk about, just remember one point, it is also effective against anaerobes. against anaerobes, it is also effective, chloramphenicol. Okay, so this is the spectrum of activity where we generally use chloramphenicol. Now let's talk about the side effect. The main reason why the use of chloramphenicol has been declined is one, because of resistance, and second is due to side effect. Now if you talk about chloramphenicol is a potent enzyme inhibitor. Okay, it inhibits the metabolizing enzymes in liver like CYP enzymes and UDP-GT enzyme. UDP, uridine diphosphate, glucuronide transferase enzyme, and CYP stand for cytochrome P enzyme. These enzymes in our body are responsible for removal of drug, degradation of drug. And chloramphenicol is a potent enzyme inhibitor. But the point is, chloramphenicol, it inhibits its own metabolism. Because of this reason, chloramphenicol gets accumulated in the body. Gets accumulated in the body, especially in neonates and preterm individuals. Neonates and preterm children. Okay, preterm. Why neonate and preterm? Because in neonate and preterm, already these enzymes are very less. And these enzymes are responsible for removal of chloramphenicol, and chloramphenicol is inhibiting this enzyme. Because of this reason, it gets accumulated in the whole body. Because of this reason, it causes multiple organ failure. It leads to multiple organ failure, and it gets accumulated in the skin. And the color of skin becomes gray. Because of this reason, it causes a syndrome known as gray baby syndrome. So chloramphenicol causes gray baby syndrome, which includes multiple organ damage, and the color of the skin also becomes gray. And it's a very dangerous condition. Because of this reason, chloramphenicol is absolutely contraindicated in neonates and preterm individuals. Okay, in preterm and neonate infants, we don't give chloramphenicol because of a dangerous side effect known as gray baby syndrome. Okay, gray baby syndrome. Why? It occurs due to accumulation of chloramphenicol in the body, which damages organ and the color of skin becomes gray. So chloramphenicol causes gray baby syndrome. And the second most dangerous side effect of chloramphenicol is bone marrow suppression. Chloramphenicol causes bone marrow suppression. And in bone marrow suppression, it can reduce all the three cells. It is the most common cause of aplastic anemia among all antimicrobial. It is the most common cause of, most commonly associated with aplastic anemia, and it's a very dangerous condition. Now this bone marrow suppression can be reversible, or you will write dose related. Okay, that means in high dose it is commonly seen, but sometimes it can be permanent also. It could be irreversible, and the only treatment is bone marrow transplant. Okay, now this irreversible, we don't know why it occurs. It's dose unrelated. It is idiosyncratic reaction. Sometimes it may cause, even in very low dose, irreversible or permanent bone marrow suppression, which is dose unrelated. It can occur in very low dose even sometimes. Okay, so it's a kind of idiosyncratic reaction. So try to remember about chloramphenicol. Okay, so this completes about chloramphenicol. Okay, hello all. Now let's start with tetracyclines. Okay, now tetracyclines, they are divided, for our convenience we can divide them into two the groups. The first group contains the older tetracyclines, which are nowadays very rarely used. These drugs are oxytetracycline. Okay, oxytetracycline, chlortetracycline, okay, and simply tetracycline. So what happened, these antimicrobials, they are obtained from bacterias, and we modify them a little bit and they form, we add oxygen group, we add chlorine group, it will become different. Now we made second generation. The second generation is totally synthetic, that is dimethylcycline. But dimethylcycline nowadays is rarely used because of lots of side effect. Okay, so now we made the most commonly used tetracycline, that is doxycycline. This is the most commonly used tetracycline nowadays because it is the longest and safest. Okay, and in some compulsion we also use minocycline also. So these two tetracyclines nowadays are commonly used, and most commonly used is doxycycline. And you can write that minocycline is most potent, it requires these dose. Okay, so first let's see what was the mechanism of action of tetracycline. The main mechanism of action of tetracycline was, it was blocking 30S ribosome. It blocks 30S ribosome and it inhibits attachment of amino acyl tRNA. Okay, it inhibits the attachment of amino acyl tRNA to A site. Okay, now we should not get confused with a similar drug, that is puromycin. Remember, puromycin is a different group, it's a different drug. Puromycin will not block the 30S ribosome. Puromycin has a structural resemblance with, or it's a structural analog of tRNA, and it does not block this site, it rather competes with tRNA for A site. Okay, so it rather competes for tRNA for A site. Now remember, puromycin is used in research purposes only, it is not given in patient, it is used in research purposes for stoppage of protein synthesis. Okay, for stoppage or premature termination of protein synthesis we use puromycin. So just remember the name, not more important for you. Now the next point is, what is the cause of resistance? So the main cause of resistance to tetracycline is the bacterias on their surface, they have started forming a transporter. This transporter will not allow tetracycline to come inside. So why there is a resistance? Because of decrease in influx of tetracycline. And second point, when this generally tetracycline comes, this transporter also holds this tetracycline and throws back again due to increase in efflux. Okay, so the resistance to tetracycline in a bacteria, it due to presence of a special transporter. This special transporter causes reduced entry and more exit of tetracycline, hence the level of tetracycline in the bacteria reduces. Remember, because of this reason we have made a new modification of tetracycline known as tigecycline. With tigecycline, which we will be discussing after this, there is no resistance like tetracycline in cases of tigecycline. So remember, tigecycline is a drug against which such kind of resistance is still not developed. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. Let's see the uses of tetracycline. Okay, uses of tetracycline. We will write tetracycline, most commonly we use doxycycline, and this doxycycline you will write is the drug of choice for. You will write a mnemonic ABC. Okay, you will write a mnemonic ABC, Bappi Lahiri music recording. Okay, ABC, Bappi Lahiri music recording. A stand for anthrax, it is used. Second, you will write it is the drug of choice for Brucella infection. Brucella. Brucella, remember, causes one infection known as undulant fever. Undulant fever. Okay. So remember, tetracyclines, they are the drug of choice for both treatment and prevention. Both treatment and prevention. The drug of choice is doxycycline. Okay. Drug of choice is doxycycline. Third, you will write chlamydia. In chlamydia bracket, you will write LGV. LGV stands for lymphogranuloma venerum. It's a sexually transmitted disease. Okay, drug of choice is doxycycline. You'll write Borrelia. Okay, you'll write Borrelia. Borrelia recurrentis, it generally causes one infection known as Lyme's disease. Sorry, Borrelia burgdorferi causes Lyme's disease, and recurrentis species causes relapsing fever. Relapsing fever. So Borrelia species causes Lyme disease and relapsing fever, and doxycycline is the drug of choice for both treatment and prevention for Borrelia, Brucella, etc. Third, you will write that it is given in plague prophylaxis. Only in prophylaxis of plague we give doxycycline. But if you talk about the treatment, for treatment, the drug of choice for plague is streptomycin. Okay, drug of choice is streptomycin. Then you will write leptospirosis. Again, remember, in leptospirosis both, it is the drug of choice for prophylaxis. Okay, for treatment, remember, the drug of choice is penicillin G. But even in treatment, you can add doxycycline. Okay, you can add doxycycline. Then M stands for, you'll write Mycoplasma hominis. Mycoplasma hominis also causes sexually transmitted disease. And lastly, very important, doxycycline is a drug of choice for a very dangerous infection known as rickettsial infection. Okay, it is a drug of choice for, and you will write all types of rickettsial infection. The drug of choice is doxycycline. So I'll repeat the mnemonic again: ABC, Bappi Lahiri, Music Radio. Okay, so you can write that in rickettsial disease, all type like Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Okay, you'll write scrub typhus or Brill-Sensor disease. You can write Q fever also, caused by Coxiella species. You can also write Bartonella quintana, which generally causes cat scratch disease. Okay, all these are the subspecies of rickettsia. Okay, and remember, in all rickettsial infection, the drug of choice is doxycycline. Okay, now let's see certain other miscellaneous use. Other miscellaneous use of other drugs. You'll write doxycycline is also used in. Doxycycline, it is also used in malaria prophylaxis. It is also used in malaria prophylaxis or traveler's prophylaxis in malaria. Okay. It is also given in syphilis patient who are allergic to penicillins. The drug of choice for syphilis is benzathine penicillin. In allergic disease, we give doxycycline if the patient is allergic. And lastly, you can write it is also given for pleurodesis and pericardial disease. Now, what is pleural disease and pericardial disease? Pleural is, suppose this is the lung, and lungs has two pleural membrane. One is attached to the lung, known as visceral pleura. And one is attached to the muscle outside, that is known as parietal pleura. What happens sometimes between this pleural membrane, there is collection of air, which is known as pneumothorax. This pneumothorax may compress lungs and it could be very dangerous. And similar things can occur in cases of heart also, pericardial space. So what we do in those cases of pleural and pericardial effusion or air collection, we generally fuse these two pleural membrane. When we fuse these two pleural membrane among themselves, it is known as pleurodesis or pericardialdesis. And doxycycline can be used in pleurodesis and pericardialdesis because doxycycline causes fibrosis. Fibrosis, they will link among themselves because of inflammatory reaction. Doxycycline causes inflammatory reaction and causes fusion of two pleural membrane. But remember, now the drug of choice for pleurodesis is not doxycycline. We use talc, and you can also use iodine preparations as well, okay, or alcohol preparation as well, okay. For pleurodesis, we commonly use nowadays talc. Now, next point you will write that minocycline among all tetracycline, it is the most effective against leprosy. And I will tell you, in leprosy, it is given as a drug of choice for single lesion possibacillary leprosy. Single lesion possibacillary. There, the drug of choice is minocycline. We give Rome therapy, rifampicin, ofloxacin, and minocycline. So that will be discussed in leprosy. It is also given in nocardia. It is also effective in nocardia. But remember, in nocardia, the drug of choice has become now cotrimoxazole. But minocycline can also be used for nocardia. Nocardia is an acid fast bacilli which causes opportunistic infection in HIV patients. Third, you will write dimecloscycline. Okay, dimecloscycline, you will write. Dimecloscycline nowadays is not used. The reason is dimecloscycline block vasopressin, that is ADH hormone. ADH hormone receptor in kidney. Okay, the receptors of vasopressin in kidney is known as V2 receptors. So dimecloscycline blocks V2 receptor on kidney. Because of this reason, ADH hormone will not able to act. The side effect of dimecloscycline is it causes nephrogenic, that means kidney. And if ADH hormone will not able to act, this disease is known as diabetes insipidus. Okay, so dimecloscycline causes nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Why? Because it blocks ADH receptor on the kidney. Because of this side effect, dimecloscycline can be used when the level of ADH hormone is very high in the body. It is used in the cases of chronic SIADH. SIADH means syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. Because dimecloscycline block ADH receptor, it can be used in the treatment of SIADH, syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. Okay, SIADH. The lastly, you will write a very old drug, tetracycline. This tetracycline is still found to be effective, and it is given as a drug of choice in cases of H. pylori infection as an add-on to other drugs. It can also be given as a luminal amoebicidal agent in cases of Entamoeba histolytica infection, protozoal infection. Okay, it can be used here also. So these are the overall uses of tetracycline. Now you will write, now earlier tetracyclines were the drug of choice overall. Earlier, the tetracycline, especially doxycycline, was a drug of choice for cholera. Earlier, the drug of choice for chlamydia, especially trachoma, which occurs in eye, the drug of choice was doxycycline. And lastly, one sexually transmitted disease known as Camelobacter granulomatis. This bacteria causes one sexually transmitted disease known as donovanosis. Okay, now earlier in this condition, the drug of choice earlier was doxycycline. But now you have to remember one point. In this case, now the drug of choice has become azithromycin. Okay. Now, the drug of choice for cholera, trachoma, and donovanosis has become azithromycin. Till over, even today, doxycycline can be used, but the drug of choice has now shifted towards azithromycin. So try to remember. And the last point you will write that tetracyclines, they are not effective in. Tetracyclines, they are not effective in some other sexually transmitted disease. They are not effective in gonococcal infection. Okay, they are not effective in gonococci that causes sexually transmitted disease. You will write it is also not effective in trichomonas infection. Okay, trichomonas vaginalis infection, which also causes vaginal discharge. Now for gonococci, the drug of choice is ceftriaxone with azithromycin. Okay, so can we say that azithromycin is given for gonococcal urethritis, STD, and as well as chlamydia also? For trichomonas, now the drug of choice has become metronidazole. Okay, so here remember, try to remember that tetracyclines, they are not effective. Okay, so keep this in mind. So these are the uses and spectrum of tetracycline. Now let's talk about pharmacokinetics of tetracyclines. Okay, so pharmacokinetics, let's talk about that these tetracyclines, they, if you talk about their route of administration, they are given by all routes. They are given by all routes like oral, IV, topical, eye drops. For topical eye drops, they can be given for the treatment of ophthalmia. They can be given for treatment of ophthalmia, neonatorum. Okay, so I'll tell you the treatment of ophthalmia, neonatorum. Except the only route by which tetracyclines are not given is as a topical skin cream. It is not applied topically on skin. The reason is tetracyclines, they cause, not given topically on skin, because they cause severe photosensitivity. They cause severe photosensitivity. That is why they should not be applied topically. Okay. Now, remember, there are two groups of antibacterials which should not be given topically on skin because they cause photosensitivity. The first is tetracycline group. And second, you will write as fluoroquinolones. These two groups of drug, they are not given topically on skin. Okay. Now, if somebody will ask you which of the tetracycline causes maximum photosensitivity, maximum you will write is caused by dimeclocycline. Dimeclocycline followed by doxycycline. Okay, followed by doxycycline. And if somebody will ask you fluoroquinolone, which causes maximum photosensitivity, you will write that is sparfloxacin. That causes maximum. Other are clinafloxacin. You can also write lomifloxacin. But what you have to remember is the name, that is sparfloxacin. So fluoroquinolones and tetracyclines, they should not be given topically on the skin. The reason is they cause photosensitivity. Hence, tetracycline and fluoroquinolone should be avoided. Now, second point is tetracycline. So this was their route of administration. The only route which where they are not given is topical. Now, before going further, let's see what are the drugs we use for ophthalmia neonatorum. In ophthalmia neonatorum, we use three drugs which are given as a topical eye drops. Okay, three drugs we can use which can be given as a topical eye drops. So you can write those drugs. You can write erythromycin. Okay, erythromycin, which is given as a 0.5% eye drops. You can also write tetracyclines, which can be given as a 1% eye drop. And lastly, you can also write silver nitrate. Which is also given as a 1% eye drop. Okay. So these drugs can be given for ophthalmia neonatorum. Okay. So the route of administration of tetracycline, now we know, is all except topical on skin. The reason is photosensitivity. Now let's talk about forward any other point. So these tetracyclines, you will write, they chelate with calcium and other divalent atoms, in our body. But this calcium is specially important. The reason is, as they are getting chelated with calcium, you will write, because of this reason, first point, that tetracycline should be given empty stomach. They should be given empty stomach, and they should not be given with food, especially dairy product or milk containing food, because milk containing food, they contain lot of calcium and other divalent atoms. They will chelate with tetracycline and their absorption will be delayed. Okay, so milk, yogurt, cheese, etc., they should not be given. Second point, you will write that they should not be given with divalent drugs known as antacids. Antacids, they contain divalent magnesium, calcium, etc. So antacid will decrease absorption of tetracycline. So they should never be given with antacids. Okay, so try to remember, and they should be taken as an empty stomach. Second point, you will write that these tetracyclines, they should be avoided in children. They are absolutely contraindicated in children less than 8 years of age. Okay, they are contraindicated in children less than 8 years of age because of the reason, they chelate with calcium present in the bone, hence they cause growth retardation. Because the calcium will be chelated with tetracycline and the bones will not grow properly. So it can lead to short stature. And they prevent or they damage or destroy the eruption of teeth. So eruption of teeth will be delayed. And the teeth which are there, remember, it leads to discoloration or mottling of teeth. Because they chelate with the calcium present in teeth also. Third point, you will write that tetracyclines, they are absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. The reason is, they cause in mothers they get chelated with the calcium present in bile and it leads to cholestatic jaundice, and cholestatic jaundice in pregnancy could be dangerous. This bilirubin may damage fetus, which may lead to meconium stained liquid, and in fetus these tetracycline, they will chelate with bone and cartilage, and bone and cartilage defect will come. Okay, bone and cartilage defect or teratogenic effect will come. Hence it is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy also. So it is both because of calcium. Okay, try to remember. Any other antimicrobial which also chelates with calcium and can produce same effect? Yes, you will write, other agents which also chelate with calcium are, you will write, fluoroquinolones. Fluoroquinolones also show same type of property. And you can also write one antifungal, ketoconazole. So these drugs, they also chelate with metals, and they should, all these precautions should be taken while taking these drugs. Okay. Now let's move forward. That tetracyclines, they are absolutely contraindicated in hepatic disease or hepatic failure. or liver disease, because they themselves are hepatotoxic and they all are, you will write, all are contraindicated in hepatic failure, and you will write they all are contraindicated in renal failure also. They all are contraindicated in kidney disease also, except one. There is only one tetracycline which can be given in renal failure, that is doxycycline. So doxycycline can be given in renal failure, but remember, doxycycline is contraindicated in hepatic failure. Okay, so in hepatic failure all are contraindicated, in renal failure all are contraindicated except doxycycline. Doxycycline can be given in renal failure. The reason is doxycycline is eliminated out in bile also, eliminated in bile as well as urine. In case of renal failure, its biliary excretion will increase. Okay, so doxycycline is safe in renal failure. So this is an important question. Rest all other tetracyclines are contraindicated in renal failure, and in hepatic failure all are contraindicated. Okay, now let's talk about their side effect. Okay, so there's some specific side effect we can write, that these tetracyclines, they cause Fanconi syndrome. Okay, now in Fanconi syndrome, it is also known as RTA type 2, renal tubular acidosis type 2. Here the PCT of kidney will not function, proximal convoluted tubule of the kidney doesn't function. It is generally seen after the, if a person consume expired tetracyclines. So after expiry, the expired tetracycline, they have reported to cause Fanconi syndrome. Okay, you'll write they cause increase in intracranial tension, which condition is known as pseudotumor cerebri. Pseudotumor cerebri. So pseudotumor cerebri is mainly because of increase in production of CSF. Okay, what are the drugs which causes pseudotumor cerebri? You can write a mnemonic, VOT. So this is, these are the three most common drug which causes pseudotumor cerebri: vitamin A, oral contraceptive pills, and tetracyclines. So these drugs, they cause pseudotumor cerebri. Okay, so try to remember. Next you will write that they are vestibulotoxic. Remember, the only tetracycline that is vestibulotoxic is minocycline. Minocycline is vestibulotoxic. Okay, minocycline is vestibulotoxic. So try to remember these three specific side effects of tetracyclines. Okay, specific side effect of tetracycline. Now we have modified tetracycline and made a new drug. That new drug, which is a modification of tetracycline, is a tigecycline. Okay, now what was the mechanism of action of tigecycline? You'll write same like tetracycline. It also blocks 30S ribosome and inhibit the attachment of aminoacyl tRNA. Okay, it's same like tetracycline. Now the point is, this group of tigecycline, this group or the structure of tigecycline is known as, it is not tetracycline group, this group is known as, although it is made from tetracycline, but this group is known as glycyl cyclines. This group is known as glycyl cycline group. Okay, so try to remember. Now the mechanism of action is same like tetracycline, but the great advantage is, still the resistance is not developed against tigecycline. That means it is even effective in resistant cases of tetracycline. It is even effective in resistant cases of tetracycline. Okay, second advantage you will write, that it is renal safe. Unlike tetracyclines, which were contraindicated in renal failure except doxy, tigecycline is renal safe. And the resistance against tigecycline right now has not been developed. Because of this reason, it is a reserve drug right now. We don't use tigecycline commonly. It's a reserve drug, not routinely given. And this reserve drug is given only IV in hospitalized patient, okay, who are suffering from very serious disease. Okay, so it is given in hospitalized patient, and this tigecycline is mainly effective against Streptococcus pneumoniae, sorry, Streptococcus pyogenes. You'll write not pneumonia. It is also given in Staph aureus. Especially with Staph aureus, you will write MRSA, VRSA, LRSA, SRSA. So as a result, it can be given. And lastly, you can write it can be given in enterococci. Enterococci. So in which infection of these drugs, you will write it is given in community acquired pneumonia, which is a very common side effect of Streptococcus pyogenes and Staph aureus. Okay, community acquired pneumonias in those patients who have become hospitalized. And for enterococci, you can write very commonly it causes skin and soft tissue infection. So skin and soft tissue infection caused by these gram-positive bacterias. Okay, so tigecycline right now, you have to remember 3 points. Its mechanism is same like tetracycline. It has glycylcycline group of antibiotic, and remember 3 R. Resistance right now have not been developed. It's renal safe and reserve drug. Okay, so this is about tetracyclines and tigecycline. Okay. So let's talk about now macrolides. Now we know the mechanism of action of macrolides. Macrolides, they block 50S ribosome and they inhibit a step known as translocation. They inhibit a step translocation. Okay. Now resistance to macrolides, they occurs because there is decrease in binding of macrolide. The bacteria forms some different type of ribosome and there is decrease in binding to ribosomes. Which ribosome? 50S ribosomes. And we know that on this same site, clindamycin and streptogramins, they also bind to the same site where macrolides, they get bind. Because of this reason, with macrolide, clindamycin and streptogramins, they show cross resistance because they have exactly same mechanism of action, same binding site on ribosomes, and a bacteria forms different kind of ribosome where macrolide affinity is very less, they cannot bind. Okay, now let's see what are the drugs we have. The drugs among macrolide, remember, they will end with the word thromycin. They end with the word thromycin, and they can be given by all route like oral, they can be given IV, they can be given as a topical skin or eye drop. They can be given by all routes. Now you can write one mnemonic for the drugs CARES. So all will end with the word thromycin. There will be one exception which I will be telling you. So the first drug you will write is clarithromycin. The best drug we have, the longest and the safest one we have, is azithromycin, roxithromycin. The first drug which we developed was erythromycin. Okay. And lastly, we have spiramycin. Okay. Lastly, we have spiramycin. So let's discuss about these drugs individually one by one. So okay, so before coming to this, their uses, you must remember one point, very important point is, so there is a drug known as tacrolimus. There is a drug known as tacrolimus, which another name is FK506. So this tacrolimus is an immunomodulator or immunosuppressant. That means it reduces the immunity of the body. It reduces the immunity of the body. And now this tacrolimus is the drug of choice for both kidney and liver transplant patient, because in that we have to reduce the immunity. Now the point is, this tacrolimus has macrolide structure. The structure of tacrolimus is macrolide. Because of this reason, we can conclude one thing, that macrolides, they have immunomodulatory properties. So these drugs, they also have immunomodulatory property. They also reduce the immunity of the body. Okay? They also are the immunomodulators. Now the second point you will write, there is a drug known as telithromycin. Okay? Telithromycin. This drug is also ending with the word thromycin. But remember, it is not a macrolide. It is not a macrolide. It is rather a ketolide. Its structure is rather a ketolide. Sir, but what is the mechanism of action? The mechanism of action is exactly same like a macrolide. Just the structure is different. Okay? So only the structure is different. So let's talk about the drugs among macrolide. So remember, they all are ending with the word thromycin except spiramycin. Okay? So let's see first uses of these drugs. Okay, uses. So the first drug which we made was erythromycin. It was the first macrolide to be made. But this erythromycin has certain drawbacks. The drawbacks of erythromycin was the shortest acting drug. It is given four times a day. Four times a day is known as QID. Okay, it's an enzyme inhibitor. Okay, so it has lot of drug interactions. It has lot of drug interactions. And lastly, erythromycin causes increase in QT interval on heart, on ECG, which can predispose to arrhythmias like torsade de Pointes. Okay, torsade de Pointes. Just remember, all macrolides can cause increase in QT interval prolongation. All macrolides can do this. Increase in QT interval prolongation, but it is minimum seen with, you will write, with azithromycin. So azithromycin is found to be the safest one. Okay, so keep this thing in mind, that erythromycin has certain drawbacks. Now what is the use of erythromycin? Erythromycin, you can write, is a drug of choice for diphtheria infection, both for treatment and prevention. The drug of choice for diphtheria is erythromycin. And erythromycin can be given topically on skin for the treatment of acne. And it can be given as a topical eye drops for the treatment of ophthalmia neonatorum. Okay? So that we know. Now, second point you will write, the second drug is clarithromycin. Now, clarithromycin is more effective against two bacteria. One is Helicobacter pylori, where it is the drug of choice, H. pylori peptic ulcers, and it is also given for MAC infection. MAC stands for Mycobacterium avium complex. Mycobacterium avium complex causes opportunistic infection in HIV patient. So here for treatment we give clarithromycin, but remember, for here you can also use a drug, here you can also use a drug azithromycin, but clarithro is more preferred in the treatment. I will be telling you when we will be discussing MAC infection in detail later on. Okay, now you will write spiramycin. Okay, spiramycin is the drug of choice for toxoplasmosis, but in pregnancy. because macrolides, they are safe drug in pregnancy. So toxoplasmosis in pregnancy, the drug of choice is spiramycin. But if it is not in pregnancy, then remember the overall drug of choice for toxoplasmosis is sulfadiazine plus pyrimethamine combination. Normally it is the treatment of choice. These drugs, they inhibit folic acid. So we don't give folate inhibitors in pregnancy, hence we generally give spiramycin in pregnancy. And we can add one drug in resistant cases, that is clindamycin. So this three drug combination we give in cases of toxoplasma. But remember, toxoplasmosis in pregnancy, then the answer will be spiramycin, because these antifolate drugs are generally avoided. Okay, now the next drug we have, the best drug, that is azithromycin. Okay, azithromycin. And you will write that azithromycin, overall we have the longest acting drug. It is the longest acting drug we have. It has the longest half-life of 2 to 4 days. Half-life is 2 to 4 days. And it is the safest macrolide we have. Why? Because it has no drug interactions. Because it does not get metabolized by any CYP. It is not an enzyme inhibitor. Erythromycin was an enzyme inhibitor. Azithro is not an enzyme inhibitor. Because of this reason, it is one of the safest drug we have to be combined with other drugs. Okay. Now, the good thing with azithromycin is, unlike tetracyclines, which we have discussed, and fluoroquinolones, azithromycin and macrolide, they are safe in pregnancy. Okay, so macrolides, they are safe in pregnancy. And remember, they can be taken with food. Why? Because they do not chelate with calcium. Because tetracycline and fluoroquinolones, they generally chelate with calcium. So because of this reason, they are much safer options we have. Okay, much safer options we have. So let's see, keeping this thing in mind, what are the uses of azithromycin? Uses. Okay, so we will write the uses of azithromycin. So azithromycin, you will write, it is the drug of choice in certain conditions. You will write triple C, SLAP. The drug of choice for all these conditions will be azithromycin. You'll write, now the drug of choice for cholera has become azithromycin. Azithromycin is the drug of choice for both treatment and prevention of cholera. It has also now have become the drug of choice for chlamydia. Like one eye infection known as trachoma. In trachoma, now earlier the drug of choice was doxycycline. Now the treatment for trachoma is single dose azithromycin. This is now the treatment of trachoma. Earlier we used to give, even today we can use doxycycline 100 milligram for 5 days, but better we have a single dose azithromycin for chlamydia. You'll write Chamylobacterium or Chamylobacter granulomatis. Which causes one infection known as donovanosis. The drug of choice is, again azithromycin. You'll write one more C. The drug of choice for chancroid, another sexually transmitted disease, is again your azithromycin. It is caused by Haemophilus Dukeri, a bacteria known as Haemophilus Dukeri. Now you will write azithromycin is the drug of choice for STDs, sexually transmitted disease. Sir, whether it is gonococci or non-gonococci. Non-gonococci, the most common cause is chlamydia, which causes one infection LGV, lymphogranuloma venereum. Now remember, in gonococci we give azithromycin with add-on drug to ceftriaxone. But remember, ceftriaxone is not effective in chlamydia because ceftriaxone is a cell wall inhibitor and chlamydia does not contain cell wall. Here we add a drug doxycycline, and in both condition we give azithromycin. Azithromycin is the only drug which is effective in all causes of sexually transmitted disease, whether it is gonococci or non-gonococci. The only drug we have is azithromycin. Nowadays we give 2 grams of azithromycin. Okay, 2 grams. Now azithromycin is also the drug of choice for Legionella pneumonia. Okay, Legionella pneumonia. And nowadays we are very commonly using fluoroquinolones also in Legionella pneumonia. You'll write atypical pneumonia, which is caused by atypical bacteria known as Mycoplasma pneumoniae, which is also a very common cause of pneumonia. Because of this reason, azithromycin now has become the drug of choice for community acquired pneumonia. Because it is used in variety of pneumonias, azithromycin now has become an oral or an IV drug for community acquired pneumonias. Okay, and lastly you will write azithromycin is also the drug of choice for pertussis, which is also known as whooping cough, which is caused by Bordetella pertussis. Bordetella pertussis bacteria. Okay, Bordetella pertussis bacteria. So try to remember this part. So these are the uses of azithromycin. These are the uses of azithromycin. Now what is the advantage of azithromycin over tetracycline? Remember, it is safe in children. Okay, remember tetracyclines, they were contraindicated in children less than 8 years of age. Okay, and fluoroquinolones are generally avoided in less than 18 years of age, and they are safe in renal and hepatic failure. Tetracyclines were contraindicated. They are also safe in pregnancy. Tetracycline was contraindicated in pregnancy. Okay, now just remember one exception. There is one macrolide known as estrolate salt. Remember, there is a drug known as erythromycin. Erythromycin is safe, but there is a salt of erythromycin known as estrolate salt. So this estrolate salt is a culprit and it should be avoided or contraindicated in pregnancy because it causes cholestatic jaundice. Okay, so macrolides, they themselves are not the culprit, but their estrolate salt is culprit in pregnancy and they should be avoided in pregnancy. Okay, so they are safe in renal failure, no dose reduction. They are safe in children, safe in pregnancy, but tetracycline in those conditions were absolutely contraindicated. Now let's see their side effects. The side effect of macrolides, you can write a mnemonic that is macro only. Okay, so M stands for motilin receptors. Macrolides, they stimulate a motilin receptor, which is a receptor in our GIT. In GIT smooth muscles, there is a receptor known as motilin receptor. And specially erythromycin is the drug which has maximum activity. Erythromycin stimulates this motilin receptor. Because of this reason, there is increase in GIT motility. Stomach and intestinal motility increases. Because of this reason, erythromycin has the drug of choice for when the stomach is not contracting. It has become the drug of choice for gastroparesis. When the stomach is not contracting, erythromycin has become the drug of choice. But what is the side effect? If intestine will contract, it will lead to diarrhea due to contraction of intestine. And due to closure of sphincter, you can write it may aggravate hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Erythromycin may aggravate hypertoric pyloric stenosis which can be seen in small children which are born due to congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis is aggravated by erythromycin. So as erythromycin is increasing the motility of stomach, it is used in the treatment of stomach paralysis known as gastroparalysis, but it itself causes diarrhea and hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. Okay, now they may cause, okay, so try to remember. Now you will write that they may cause allergic reactions, cholestatic jaundice. Cholestatic jaundice in pregnancy, we have already discussed, is caused by one salt of erythromycin. You will write estrolate salt. This estrolate salt is contraindicated in pregnancy. Otherwise, macrolides are safe in pregnancy. You will write they reduce immunity of the body and they cause ototoxicity. But remember, their ototoxicity is reversible in nature. It is not permanent. They cause reversible ototoxicity. So try to remember the side effects of macrolides. Okay, side effect of macrolides. So before jumping on to the next drug, let's see antimicrobial in pregnancy. Antimicrobial in pregnancy. Okay, you'll write safest. Safest means they are category B drugs. Okay, category B drugs, and you will write the drugs are PCM, that is penicillin, cephalosporin and macrolides. They are safe in pregnancy. The drugs which is contraindicated or avoided, why? Because they are category D. Category D means they are teratogenic drug. They are only used if there is some life-threatening condition. Only then they are used. You'll write fats. So these drugs are very dangerous drugs, should not be given in pregnancy. You'll write fluoroquinolones. They cause bone and cartilage defect. Bone and cartilage. You'll write aminoglycoside. Aminoglycosides, they may cause ear damage or neurotoxicity. Then you will write tetracyclines. Again, they may cause bone and cartilage defect. And then you will write sulfonamide. Okay, sulfonamides. So these drugs should be avoided generally in pregnancy. Okay. So this is about tetracycline and macrolide group of antibiotic. Okay. So let's start with now aminoglycosides. We know the mechanism of action of aminoglycosides. Aminoglycosides, they bind to multiple sites. They bind to multiple sites of 50S and 30S ribosomes. There will be one exception. That exception is streptomycin. Streptomycin only binds to 30S ribosome. Okay, streptomycin only 30S ribosome, and they inhibit multiple steps. And they inhibit multiple steps. Those multiple steps we have already discussed. They inhibit initiation of protein synthesis. They cause misreading of mRNA. A different type of amino acid will come and join there. And they inhibit the assembly of polysome. Polysome is the assembly between ribosomes and mRNA. Okay, polysome formation. So they inhibit polysome formation also. Now the point is, let's talk about the cause of resistance now. The cause of resistance. The cause of resistance is again that enzymatic degradation. Okay, enzymatic degradation. So bacteria, they have started producing an enzyme, and those enzymes generally degrades aminoglycoside except one. one aminoglycoside against which the bacteria are unable to produce degrading enzyme, that is amikacin. Against amikacin, right now the enzymes are not formed specific to amikacin. Because of this reason, this amikacin, there is no resistance, and we can say that amikacin can be given in resistant cases of other aminoglycoside. Okay, can be given in resistant cases of other aminoglycoside. Okay, now what kind of enzymes are formed which causes enzymatic degradation? You will write AAT, APT and ANT. AAT stand for aminoglycosides. Let's write the short form as AMG. Acetyl transferase. This enzyme is formed. APT is aminoglycoside. Phosphorylase transferase. And aminoglycoside nucleotide transferase, like adenyl, adenosine, etc. Nucleotide transferase. Because of attachment of these molecules by the bacteria, aminoglycoside become neutralized. They are unable to act. Okay. Now let's talk about their spectrum. Aminoglycosides, remember, it's a very important point that aminoglycosides, they are narrow spectrum drugs. They are narrow spectrum. Remember, they are mainly given for, you will write, they are not effective in, they are not effective against anaerobic infection. Against anaerobes, they are not effective. The reason is, to enter into a bacteria, they require the help of certain oxygen dependent pump. Aminoglycoside, they require oxygen dependent pump through which they can enter into the bacteria and inhibit protein synthesis. In an anaerobe, this oxygen dependent pump is absent. Okay, so it is not effective against anaerobes. Okay, remember, they are have a very less effectiveness against gram-positive bacteria. Very less effective against gram-positive bacteria, but remember, they can be given with in cases. Why they are very less effective in gram-positive? Because in gram-positive bacteria, the cell membrane, cell wall is mainly made up of peptidoglycan. They cannot pierce this peptidoglycan. But if you remove this peptidoglycan cell wall, then this aminoglycosides can go easily. Hence, in gram-positive bacteria, they are combined with cell wall inhibitors. They are combined with cell wall inhibitors like penicillin, cephalosporins, which is known as beta-lactams, and vancomycin group. Because aminoglycosides, when combined with a cell wall inhibitor, now they can enter easily into the cell. And now they can be effective against gram-positive. So you will write that aminoglycosides, in cases of gram-positive bacteria, when combined with a cell wall inhibitor like beta-lactam or vancomycin, it shows 1+1:2 effect, that is known as additive effect. They show additive effect in cases of gram-positive bacteria. Otherwise, individually, they are not effective much against gram-positive. So keeping this thing in mind, can we say that aminoglycosides are mainly given against gram-negative aerobic bacterias? They are mainly given against gram-negative aerobic bacteria. This is their main spectrum. But example you will write, Enterobacteriaceae like E. coli, Pseudomonas, etc. That we will discuss shortly. Okay, but remember, there are certain gram-negative aerobic bacteria against which even aminoglycosides is not effective. You will write aminoglycosides are not effective against typhoid. Against typhoid, which is a gram-negative aerobic bacteria caused by Salmonella, this aminoglycosides, they are not effective. You can write that it is also not effective against Burkholderia species, which is similar to Pseudomonas species. Remember, aminoglycosides are not effective against Burkholderia species. Okay, like Burkholderia pseudomallei, which causes melioidosis. Burkholderia capsica, which causes lung infection. So aminoglycosides are not effective against certain gram negative aerobic also. So they have a very small spectrum, a very narrow spectrum of action. Okay, so try to remember. Now the third point you will write that aminoglycosides, they show concentration dependent killing. That means if you will give very high dose, they show rapid killing of a bacteria. That is why they are given once a day dose, but in very high dose, because higher the concentration, more killing is seen. Plus they have post antibiotic effect. Post antibiotic effect is that even after stoppage, the bacteria will keep on be killed by this bacteria, by these aminoglycoside, which is known as post antibiotic effect. Even their concentration falls, the bacteria will keep on killing. Okay, because they stimulate our body immunity. Okay, and now let's talk about their pharmacokinetics. The first pharmacokinetic is aminoglycosides, they are highly polar compounds. They are highly polar compounds. That means they are highly ionic or water soluble. Because of this reason, this aminoglycoside, they have a very poor oral absorption. Hence, for systemic infection, they are not given orally, they are only given for injection. If the infection is in the whole body, we give by injection. Orally, they are not absorbed. Okay, you'll write they have very poor blood-brain barrier penetration. Okay, they have a very poor blood-brain barrier penetration, but remember, they are given in cases of meningitis. The reason why it is given in cases of meningitis, because the blood-brain barrier becomes disrupted in cases of meningitis. The blood-brain barrier becomes destroyed. Hence, now these aminoglycosides can now easily enter into the brain. Okay, try to remember. So remember, they have mainly extracellular, they don't enter into the cell because of their highly water soluble nature. They have extracellular, they have only extracellular distribution in the body. They cannot enter into the cell. So they only kill those bacteria which are outside the cell. They cannot kill the bacteria which are inside the cell. Example, they cannot kill the bacteria which are inside the cell, like chlamydia. They cannot kill the bacteria which are inside the cell, like rickettsia. Okay, mycoplasma. Against them, generally, they are not effective because they have extracellular deposition. Okay, now just the last point you have to remember, aminoglycosides, they are absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. They are category D drug, which we have already discussed. They are only given in pregnancy if there is some life-threatening infection. Otherwise, routinely, they are not given in pregnancy. Okay, routinely, they are not given in pregnancy. So try to remember this point. Now let's see what are the drugs we have among aminoglycosides. Now drugs among aminoglycoside, remember, either they will end with the word mycin or they will end with the word mycin. Okay, example, streptomycin. Example, you will write gentamicin. The reason is why they are ending with a different name, because mycin wale, they are obtained from mycins, they are obtained from streptomyces. They are obtained from streptomyces, MY word is coming. And mycin, they are obtained from micromonospora. micro monospora. So some of the aminoglycosides, they are ending with the word mycin, and some of them they end with the word mycins. So keeping this thing in mind, let's see certain aminoglycosides and their uses. The first drug you will write is streptomycin. Okay. Now streptomycin you can write is the drug of choice for TB. Okay. Drug of choice for tuberculosis. It is also the drug of choice for, you will write, plague. Okay. For treatment of plague. And it can also be given in cases of brucella along with doxycycline. Okay. So streptomycin is the drug of choice here. Second, you will write amikacin, capreomycin, and kanamycin. Okay. Remember, this capreomycin is not an aminoglycoside in structure, but its action is just like aminoglycoside. So we generally place capreomycin out here. So these aminoglycosides, they are approved for MDR-TB, that is multi-drug resistant TB. So remember, streptomycin is given in normal TB. This ACK drugs are given in MDR-TB. So overall, we have four classes, four aminoglycosides which are given in TB. The mnemonic is SAC. So four aminoglycosides, they are given in TB: streptomycin, amikacin, capreomycin, and kanamycin. Okay, so try to remember. Third point, you will write that aminoglycosides which are effective against Pseudomonas. Against Pseudomonas, you will write gentamicin, amikacin, and tobramycin. These aminoglycosides, they are given for the treatment of Pseudomonas infection. Okay. Now for systemic Pseudomonas infection, remember, now the treatment for Pseudomonas is injections of ceftazidime, which is a third generation cephalosporin active against Pseudomonas, with gentamicin. This is the standard treatment protocol. In gentamicin resistant cases, you can give amikacin. Okay, you can give amikacin. Now remember, in ceftazidime resistant cases, you can give carbapenems. Okay, and in carbapenem resistant cases, you can give colistin. And remember, all these drugs which we have written are injectable drug. The only oral drug for Pseudomonas we have is ciprofloxacin. It is an oral drug for Pseudomonas. So this is the treatment of Pseudomonas. Now this tobramycin, if we talk about, this tobramycin is available as an inhaled powder. It is given as an inhaled drug also, around 300 milligram. And it is the drug of choice for Pseudomonas in cases of cystic fibrosis. In cases of cystic fibrosis, the mucus in the lung becomes very hard and the patient has recurrent Pseudomonas infection. So in that case, we can give inhaled tobramycin 300 milligram for cystic fibrosis. Okay. Remember, this tobramycin, this tobramycin is also available as a topical eye drops for corneal ulcers, for corneal ulcer. So it is generally given as an ointment, and the strength of this ointment is 0.3%. The strength of this ointment in eye is 0.3%. Okay, so try to remember. Now fifth point, you will write, you'll write paromomycin. Now paromomycin you can write Paromomycin can be given in protozoal infection. It can be given in protozoans. Injection of paromomycin is an approved drug for a protozoa known as Leishmania, known as Kala Azar, Leishmania donovani. Okay? And remember, paromomycin can also be given orally. And orally, it will not absorb into the blood from GIT because it's a highly water soluble, but it will kill the infection which is present in GIT. It is given for luminal amebiasis. And it is the drug of choice in this case, luminal amebiasis, paromomycin. Because oral paromomycin will not be absorbed. Luminal amebiasis is caused by entamoeba, again a protozoa. And now you will write 6 point. There is a drug known as fremicitin. Fremicitin is given as a topical skin cream. Okay, and this is known as, it comes with the brand name known as soframycin. I hope you must be knowing about soframycin. Okay, soframycin creams. Similarly, you will write, we have a drug known as neomycin. Now, neomycin, remember, it can be given as a topical skin cream. Okay, which comes with the brand name Neosporin. Which comes with the brand name Neosporin cream, neomycin. And this neomycin can also be given orally, and it can be given orally to kill GIT bacteria. To kill GIT bacteria in cases of a disease known as, because GIT bacteria, they produce ammonia, and ammonia in case of liver failure will not be converted into urea, and this ammonia can damage brain. So it is given in cases of cirrhosis of liver, because in cirrhosis of liver, liver damage can lead to hepatic encephalopathy. This ammonia can enter into the brain. Okay, which may damage the brain. To kill this GIT bacteria, we give hepatic encephalopathy. So let's see the treatment of hepatic encephalopathy. Sir, suppose this is the GIT and these are the bacteria in GIT. Remember, the bacteria in GIT forms ammonia. Normally, this ammonia goes into the portal vein blood and it goes to the liver. And liver generally converts this ammonia into a non-toxic substance, urea. But in cases of cirrhosis of liver, when the liver has been damaged, this ammonia will not be converted into urea, and this ammonia may enter into the brain, and it may cause brain damage, which is known as hepatic encephalopathy, which is seen in cases of cirrhosis. Now, what is the treatment of hepatic encephalopathy? You will write, hepatic encephalopathy in mild cases. In mild cases, we will not kill the bacteria. In mild cases, we can give syrup of lactulose. Now, lactulose, it will just convert ammonia into ammonium. It will convert ammonia into ammonium. And this ammonium, it cannot be absorbed into portal vein because it is water soluble. So, lactulose will decrease absorption of ammonia because it will convert ammonia into ammonium. But in moderate to severe cases, we will kill the bacteria. We will kill the bacteria. The best drug we have is known as rifaximin. But you can also give neomycin orally. Okay? So it is generally now considered as a drug of choice for hepatic encephalopathy, rifaximin. Okay, so try to remember this. Okay, try to remember. Now the next use of aminoglycoside, you will write is spectinomycin. Okay, now spectinomycin is a drug of choice for Neisseria gonorrhea. Okay, Neisseria gonorrhea. Now remember, for Neisseria gonorrhea we made penicillin G as a drug of choice, but now this Neisseria gonorrhea has been producing a new strain of Neisseria gonorrhea has come, known as PPNG. PPNG stands for penicillinase producing Neisseria gonorrhea. So if it is producing this penicillinase producing Neisseria gonorrhea, penicillin G will not be effective, and in that case the drug of choice is spectinomycin as a single dose. We give a single dose of spectinomycin for the treatment of penicillinase producing Neisseria gonorrhea, and you will write it is also the drug of choice in allergic cases. If the patient is allergic to penicillin, we can give spectinomycin. So spectinomycin is given in two conditions. If the Neisseria gonorrhea is producing penicillinase enzyme, and secondly, if the patient is allergic to penicillin, in these two cases we give spectinomycin. Okay, so try to remember this part. Now next point is, what is the side effect of aminoglycosides? Okay, side effects of aminoglycoside. The classical side effect of aminoglycosides are three. You'll write ototoxic, nephrotoxic, and they block neuromuscular junction blockage. Okay, they block neuromuscular junction. Okay, so you will write first most ototoxic and least ototoxic aminoglycoside, and then we will discuss their toxicity in great detail. Now ototoxic means ear. If you talk about ototoxicity, ear has two parts. One is cochlea, second is vestibule. Okay, so you will write most ototoxic cochleotoxic is, you will write most cochleotoxic is, you will write KAN, CAN, kanamycin. Even more than kanamycin, amikacin. And even more than amikacin is neomycin. So neomycin is the most cochleotoxic aminoglycoside. And among vestibule, you will write most vestibular toxic is streptomycin. So the drugs you were using for MDR TB are most cochleotoxic, and the drug you are using for normal TB is this one. Okay, so if you talk about least in both cases, whether it is cochlea or vestibule, is natalimycin. Natalimycin is least cochlear and vestibular toxic. Now let's talk about nephrotoxic. Most nephrotoxic is again neomycin, and most neuromuscular junction is again neomycin. As you are seeing, neomycin is coming everywhere, most. Because of this reason, we don't give neomycin injection to our patient, because it is the most toxic aminoglycoside we have is neomycin. That is why we don't give neomycin as an injection. Yes, it can be given orally. So the most toxic nephrotoxic now you will write is gentamicin. Gentamicin, and least you will write here as streptomycin. Least you will write here is streptomycin. Okay, now you will write here we don't use neomycin, hence you will write the maximum neuromuscular junction blockage is by streptomycin. After neomycin, maximum is streptomycin. And the last point you will write least neuromuscular junction blockage is by tobramycin. Least is by tobramycin. So these are the least. Okay, so least ototoxic was natalimycin, least nephrotoxic streptomycin, and least neuromuscular blockage is by tobramycin. So let's talk about these points in great details. The first is ototoxicity. You'll write ototoxicity is due to is permanent or irreversible. Why? Because it is due to direct damage to hair cells in our ear. And hair cells are nothing, they are neurons. And neurons, we know, they cannot multiply. Hence, ototoxicity is always irreversible. But you can write that we can give calcium as antidote in early cases. Calcium can be given as an antidote in early cases. Okay? So try to remember. It becomes irreversible and permanent damage to hair cell if it is more than 1 month. If you are giving these aminoglycosides for more than 1 month, it can be. And it is increased by other ototoxic drug. If you are combining this aminoglycoside with other ototoxic drug, ototoxicity can be increased. So you'll just write a mnemonic of other ototoxic drug. So ototoxic drugs, you'll write one mnemonic, that is Kam, Dev, okay, Pass. So C stand for anti-cancer drug or cytotoxic agent, that is cisplatin and cyclophosphamide. They are highly ototoxic drug. You'll write aminoglycosides, which we were discussing. They cause permanent ear damage. And you know, maximum most cochleotoxic is CAN and most vestibulotoxic is streptomycin. Then you will write minocycline. Minocycline is only and only vestibulotoxic. It has no effect on cochlea. Okay? Then you will write diuretics, especially loop diuretic like ethacrynic acid. Furosemide, E for erythromycin or macrolides, and we have discussed that macrolide, they cause reversible ototoxicity, not permanent. Okay, V for vancomycin, A for amphotericin B, you will write penicillamine and gold. These drugs are used in RA, rheumatoid arthritis. You'll write anti-malarials, chloroquine, quinine, etc. Salicylates or NSAIDs like aspirin. And lastly, smoking. So this is the complete list of the drugs which are ototoxic, and these drugs should not be combined with each other. Now let's talk about the second point, that is nephrotoxicity. Okay, now unlike ototoxicity, remember nephrotoxicity is reversible because it occurs due to damage of epithelial cells. So it's a tubule, they cause just damage of epithelial cells, and epithelial cells can regenerate. Epithelial cells can regenerate. Okay, so remember it is reversible. Remember, if it will lead to interstitial nephritis is permanent. Interstitial nephritis, if it occurs below the epithelial cell, then it is permanent. Remember, aminoglycoside, they do not cause interstitial nephritis, which is a permanent form of renal damage. Okay, so they just cause reversible form of renal damage. Okay, so try to remember. Now the second point is, most commonly the cells which are damaged is of cells of PCT, that is proximal convoluted tubule. These are the most commonly PCT of the nephron, kidney most commonly does. Now you will write these aminoglycosides, they are not contraindicated. Remember, they require reduction of dose reduction of dose. So remember, aminoglycosides, they require reduction of dose in renal failure. Because they are excreted through kidney, they require reduction of dose in renal failure. And you can write in elderly people also, because in elderly age, the renal function already declines. Okay. Also, when they are given in very high dose, they should not be given in high dose. And in cases of hypokalemia, because they aggravate hypokalemia by damage to PCT, they require reduction of dose. Okay. So try to remember that in these cases, aminoglycosides, especially in elderly patient and renal failure, they require dose reduction. Also in high dose and hypokalemia, aminoglycosides, they require dose reduction in renal failure. Okay. So how much dose must be reduced? Remember, if the GFR is, which is given in ml per minute, if it is 70, you'll write, if the creatinine clearance, which is given in ml per minute equivalent to GFR, if it is 70, the dose reduction that will be required, the dose reduction, you will write, the dose you will be giving is 70% of daily dose. So reduce the dose by 30%. Okay, then you can write 50. Here we'll write 50% of the daily dose. Okay, then you will write 30% of the daily dose. Okay, 20 to 30, you'll write 80% of alternative dose on alternative days. That daily dose, one day should be missed. Okay, 10 to 20. You'll write 60% on alternative day. Okay. And lastly, if there's the creatinine clearance is less than 10, then they require the dose 40% on every alternative day, not daily. In earlier, they were giving daily dose, but the dose must be reduced. Okay, so try to remember. Now the next point you will write is neuromuscular blockage. Neuromuscular blockage. Now the point is, these aminoglycosides, suppose this is a muscle, and this muscle is contracted by a receptor known as NM receptor. NM receptor is a receptor of acetylcholine. Now these aminoglycosides, they inhibit release of acetylcholine. Hence, they inhibit the muscle contraction. The muscle will not contract. Okay. Now why they inhibit the release of acetylcholine vesicles? Because to release this vesicle, the cells require calcium. Aminoglycoside, just like botulinum toxin, which also inhibit the entry of calcium, aminoglycoside also inhibit the entry of calcium, and they inhibit the release of acetylcholine from nerves. Hence, the muscle contraction will be impaired. Because of this reason, you'll write the antidote. The antidote for neuromuscular blockage is again calcium. And aminoglycoside should be avoided or not to be given in cases of, if the receptors are already blocked by an antibody. If the receptors are already blocked by an antibody, that disease is known as myasthenia gravis. So aminoglycosides should not be given in myasthenia gravis, because the muscles are already not contracting and you don't want to inhibit the further release of acetylcholine. The patient will go into respiratory muscle paralysis. Okay, so let's write the list of the drugs which are contraindicated in myasthenia gravis. Okay, so the list of the drug which are contraindicated in myasthenia gravis are, first you will write antimicrobials, which are contraindicated. So in myasthenia, drugs contraindicated in myasthenia gravis. So list you will write is antimicrobial, like aminoglycosides. Okay, aminoglycosides. Second, you will write macrolides, especially telithromycin. Telithromycin. Okay, telithromycin. Now you will write fluoroquinolones or quinolones. They should be avoided because they inhibit entry of sodium. Okay, antimalarials and certain other drugs like polymyxin, colistin and bacitracin. These antimicrobials should be avoided in myasthenia gravis, but you will write penicillins are safe. Penicillins are safe in myasthenia gravis. Okay, now just let's complete this list of other drugs. Now, other drug which should not be given in myasthenia gravis, you will write is skeletal muscle relaxant. Okay, skeletal muscle relaxants like curare, like D tubo curare, they generally end with the word curare, curonium and curium. D tubo curare. Third drug you will write is C beta blockers. Beta blockers, they inhibit muscle contraction. Further, it will lead to muscle paralysis like propranolol, atenolol and metoprolol. Okay, third drug which is contraindicated in myasthenia gravis, you'll write is anesthetic agents. Fourth, you will write antiarrhythmics, which class? Class 1A agent. Class 1A agent like lignocaine. Sorry, class 1 agent. Just remove the word A, which is sodium channel blocker. Class 1A agent like lignocaine, procainamide, etc. Because they inhibit the entry of sodium into the muscles and the muscle will not contract. Then you will write a very important drug, that is botulinum toxin, because botulinum toxin also paralyzes muscle. So botulinum toxin is absolutely contraindicated in myasthenia gravis. Okay, myasthenia gravis. And lastly, to complete the list, you can write gold and penicillamine, which are used in rheumatoid arthritis. So these are the drugs which should not be given in myasthenia gravis. Okay, so antimicrobials, which one is safe? Penicillin is safe. And these are the other drugs. Okay, these are the other drugs which are avoided in myasthenia gravis. Now let's see what are the other protein synthesis inhibitors we have. Okay, let's see the other protein synthesis inhibitors. So you will write the next class of drug among protein synthesis inhibitor is lincosamide. Okay. Now lincosamide, it contains two drugs, that is lincomycin and clindamycin. Now just remember, among them clindamycin is the most commonly used drug. Okay, so let's write where clindamycin is used. You'll write clindamycin is the drug of choice. It is the drug of choice for anaerobic infection, that is Prevotella infection. okay, it can also be given in one anaerobic infection known as bacteroides infection, Bacteroides fragilis. So in anaerobes, clindamycin is commonly used. It is a drug of choice in Prevotella. But remember, in bacteroids, now the drug of choice has become metronidazole. Now it has become metronidazole. So just try to remember, above diaphragm, Prevotella causes infection. Below diaphragm, bacteroids causes infection, intra-abdominal infection. Okay. It is also given for anaerobic streptococci. So it's a very good drug for anaerobic infection, clindamycin. Second use of clindamycin, you will write one anaerobic bacteria known as Propionibacterium acinis. This bacteria, remember, causes one disease known as acne. So again, it's a anaerobic bacteria. So the main use of clindamycin is anaerobic bacteria. Now, second use of clindamycin, you will write, clindamycin is also given in certain protozoan infection. The protozoan infection are like malaria, toxoplasma, and pneumocystis infection. It is effective against these protozoans like toxoplasma, pneumocystis, malaria. And the third use, you will write that clindamycin is the drug of choice to reduce toxin production. Because it is a protein synthesis inhibitor, it will reduce the production of toxin. To reduce toxin production in cases of a bacteria known as TSST, that is toxin shock syndrome toxin. Okay. Now, this is a very important point you must remember. It can be given in clostridial infection, because all clostridial infection like tetani, botulini, and perpharynges, they generally cause infection not because of their bacteria, they produce toxin, and to reduce toxin production we give clindamycin always. Okay. Now, what is the side effect of clindamycin? Clindamycin causes super infection. Because of rapid killing of GIT bacteria in our intestine, one harmful bacteria can grow. It can cause super infection of Clostridium difficile in the GIT. So remember, it is used in the treatment of other Clostridial infection. It itself can cause Clostridium difficile infection in our GIT. Okay, or large intestine colon. This disease is known as pseudomembranous colitis. The disease is known as pseudomembranous colitis, whose drug of choice we have discussed was oral vancomycin, better drug, or metronidazole. Okay, so this is about clindamycin. Now let's see what are the other drugs. We have linezolid. The group of linezolid is known as, you will write, oxazo, lidinidiones. Okay. Now, if you remember about linezolid, it has a very unique mechanism of action. It blocks 23S subunit of 50S. Okay. And it inhibits attachment of methionine tRNA. So, as it is having a very unique mechanism of action, till now there is no resistance against linezolid. Because of this reason, linezolid we generally give as a reserve drug. Now this linezolid is a very narrow spectrum drug. You'll write it is mainly effective against gram positive bacteria only. It is only given for gram-positive bacteria. Okay, so you will write that linezolid is given for Staphylococcus aureus. Okay, like MRSA, VRSA, and it is the drug of choice for VRSA. Okay, Staphylococcus aureus. It is also the drug of choice for Enterococcus. Again, which enterococci you will write? VRE, that is vancomycin resistant enterococci. It is also given in Streptococcus pneumoniae. Okay, it is also given in Streptococcus pneumoniae. Now just remember that in this case, linezolid is a static drug, and in Streptococcus pneumoniae, it has been a sidal drug. Okay, now recently, this linezolid has been approved for MDR-TB, multi-drug resistant TB. And here also again it is a static drug. Recently it has been approved for MDR-TB. Now let's see what is the route. Linezolid can be given as an IV drug. It can be given as an oral drug. And in oral drug, remember, it has a 100% bioavailability. That means it completely gets absorbed into the blood. Okay. Now what is the side effect? Okay. The main side effect of linezolid is, linezolid, it increases serotonin level. It increases serotonin level. Why? Because it has SSRI like action. It inhibits reuptake of serotonin by various drugs. Because of this reason, it causes, you will write, it leads to one side effect known as serotonin syndrome. Linezolid causes serotonin syndrome, and serotonin is required by platelet for their aggregation. Linezolid causes thrombocytopenia and bone marrow suppression. Okay, because of this reason, with linezolid, if you are giving for more than 2 weeks, linezolid for more than 2 weeks require platelet monitoring. If you are giving linezolid for more than 2 weeks, it requires monitoring of platelet. Okay, now we made certain newer drugs, that is tedizolid. Tedizolid is exactly same like linezolid. Okay, it is exactly same like linezolid. But you will write tedizolid is longer acting, and tedizolid, you will write, it has less bone marrow suppression as compared to linezolid. So it's more safer also, it's longer also. Okay, a new drug, sutazolid. This sutazolid right now is not approved. It is under trial for MDR-TB patients, multi-drug resistant TB. So it is right now under trial for multi-drug resistant TB. Now the next drug we have is streptogramins. Okay, streptogramins. Now among streptogramins, they are bactericidal drug. We have a combination of two drug. This combination is bactericidal. The drug name is quinpristine, delfopristine combination. Okay, quinpristine, delfopristine combination. It is combined in a ratio of 30:70. Okay, 30:70 combination. And where it is given, remember, this quinpristine and delfopristine is given by central line only, and it is given for serious gram-positive infection. लाइक लिनेजोलेट. तो यू कैन राइट लाइक एमआरएस से, वीआरएस से, इवन एलआरएस से. यू कैन ऑल्सो राइट वीआरई, यू कैन ऑल्सो राइट वीआरई, एंड इट इज वेरी कॉमनली गिवन फॉर स्ट्रेप्टोकोकस न्यूमोनिया. ओके, इफ इट इज डेंजरस इट कैन बी गिवन. ओके, नाउ द पॉइंट इज लेट्स टॉक अबाउट इट्स फार्माकोकाइनेटिक्स. स्ट्रेप्टोग्रामिन्स इट शुड नॉट बी गिवन इंट्रावीनसली बिकॉज इट कॉजेस वेस्कुलर थ्रोम्बोसिस. दैट इज वाई इट इज जनरली गिवन एज अ सेंट्रल लाइन. इट डैमेजेस वेन्स व्हेन इट इज गिवन आईवी. एंड दिस स्ट्रेप्टोग्रामिन अगेन इज अ वेरी पोटेंट एंजाइम इनहिबिटर. इट्स अ वेरी पोटेंट एंजाइम इनहिबिटर. इट इनहिबिट वेरियस सीवाईपी एंजाइम्स एंड इट शोज वेरियस लॉट ऑफ ड्रग इंटरैक्शन. Now, what is the side effect? The main side effect of streptogramins is it causes myalgia. Myos means muscle, algia means pain, arthralgia syndrome. Arthralgia means joint pain. So there will be pain in muscles and joints. Okay, it causes myalgia, arthralgia syndrome, muscles and joint pain. Okay, so this is about your protein synthesis inhibitor. Now let's write certain miscellaneous protein synthesis inhibitor or new drug, miscellaneous drugs. And remember, these drugs are generally given, these drugs are given as a topical drug. Topical drug. So the first drug you will write is mupirocin. Okay. Now mupirocin, remember, it inhibit isoleucel tRNA synthase. So it also inhibits certain protein synthesis, and it is given topically for MRSA infection, that is methicillin resistant staph aureus infection. So they are topical drug. Second, you will write fusidic acid. Now fusidic acid, it inhibit elongation factor. Okay, it inhibit elongation factor, and it is given generally for streptococcus infection. Okay, streptococcus infection. Third, you will write retapamulin. This group of retapamulin is known as pleuromutilins. This group is known as pleuromutilins. What is the mechanism of action? It inhibit peptidyl transferase, just like chloramphenicol. And this retapamulin is very commonly given in cases of Streptococcus pyogenes. Okay, Streptococcus pyogenes infection like impetigo. Okay, it is very commonly given in Streptococcus pyogenes infection. So these are the certain topical protein synthesis inhibitors we have among drugs. Okay, so try to remember them. Okay, so this completes our protein synthesis inhibitors. Thank you very much for listening.